Good morning. Welcome. We are glad to have you here with us this morning on this fall morning. Just by way of introduction and welcome, my name is Betsy, if you're not sure who I am. Pastor Ben is gone today, so we are glad to have a good friend of his, Pastor Tolley from Fremont, is here to share God's word with us, so he will be up here shortly. We also have Troy Love here from the Ladder, who is going to share a little bit about the ministry and work that is going on there that will happen in the service in a little while later. So just a word of welcome that you're here. You are invited to coffee and fellowship time afterwards just on the other side of this wall. So if you are able, please stay and visit. We would love to get to know you if you are new and just connect again if you are not new. So I just thought it would just be appropriate to start off with a few words this morning, since it is Reformation Day just around the corner here, with just a few words from Martin Luther as we get ready to worship this morning. This is that mystery which is rich in divine grace to sinners, wherein by a wonderful exchange our sins are no longer ours but Christ's, and the righteousness of Christ not Christ's but ours. He has emptied himself of his righteousness that we might clothe us with it and fill us with it. And he has taken our evils upon himself that he might deliver us from them. Learn Christ and him crucified, and learn to pray to him by saying, Lord Jesus, you are my righteousness. I am your sin. You took on you what was mine, yet set on me what was yours. You became what you were not, that I might become what I was not. Just a great words. And then this one I found, which I really appreciated. I have held many things in my hands, and I have lost them all. But whatever I have placed in God's hands, that I still possess. So as we get ready to worship about God's faithfulness and what Christ did for us, we're going to remember those words. And to do that, if you would just stand and greet somebody around you and welcome them, the praise team will come up.
Good morning, everyone. It is such a blessing to be with you all this morning. Tim and I were gone with our family for a little bit, and so we've missed you, and it's great to be back. What a blessing to be able to get away with them, too, and just enjoy one another. But it's good to be back. We're going to start with a good old hymn of the faith. Great is thy faithfulness. It's in your hymnal on page 43, if you're somebody who loves to get that book out and look at the harmonies. The second one is not from the hymnal, just so you know, but the first one is. So great is thy faithfulness, all three verses.
Change up. through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world my darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again, and as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No
just come before you this morning, and we are so thankful that with all that's going on in our world, with all the voices in this world that are not of you, that there is no scheme of man that can pluck us from your hand. Lord, may we rely on you 100%. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your love. And thank you for your grace that is new every single day. Lord, we just pray that you would bless this time together. In your name we pray. Amen.
As I said, we have Troy Love, Coach Love, from the ladder here just to share a little bit with us. So I'm going to welcome him up.
Good morning. Thank you so much. Great to worship with you this morning. That was a great worship. Hey, have you ever had something that you needed to reach that was a little high? It was a little higher. And if that's something that you've ever experienced before, you know that one thing that sometimes come in handy. ladder, right? So a ladder is awesome because it helps you to reach stuff that normally you wouldn't be able to reach on your own. It's a great thing. And you know what I'm excited to say today? That I'm so thankful that in our community, we have a ladder. We have a ladder. And one of the things that the ladder does is it helps our community reach levels that maybe on its own might struggle a little bit. So thankful for a ladder. And as I'm looking in your eyes right now, I want to say also, thank you so much that ever since the Ladder Community Center, just about 5 miles north of here, on State Street, ever since it opened, it has enjoyed the support of this body of believers right here. We are so, so thankful for your support. And so today, in the next few minutes, what I'd like to do is just share, I'd like to bombard you. All right. I would like to bombard you from this high place with all kinds of things about the ladder, not necessarily to promote the ladder, but one of the things I'd really like to do to have happen today is for every single person in here to identify with the ladder in a way that says, I need that. I need that. I desire that. Or I want to support that. Because I know that there's something for every single one of you at the Ladder Community Center. And so thanks so much for giving me your ears here for the next couple of minutes as I share what's going on at the Ladder. And all the while, if there's something that stirs inside you and says, ooh, that's good. That just might be from God saying, get in on this. Get in on this, okay? So as Betsy said, I am the youth and men's coach at the Ladder Community Center. And just starting my third year. And so one of the highlights of my job is working with the youth. So picture this, every weekday, Monday through Friday, students from Shelby High School and Shelby Middle School come walking about 5-6 blocks down the street, and they come into the ladder. And that before they even get there, I meet with a group of volunteers, beautiful people. I mean, beautiful people that love kids. And what we do is we gather around a table and we pray over our kids by name. And we pray for their families. And we pray that God would have his way in every single one of those kids and every single one of their families. And so before they even arrive, they've been covered by prayer. And so then the kids come in, probably about 3:10 or so. You guys remember what it was like after school day, right? You just want to unwind a little bit. You just want to chillax a little. And that's what the kids do. They come in, they play ping pong, they play air hockey, they shoot baskets if they want to, they bump a volleyball, play some pool. Some of them just like to play Connect Four. I mean, all just come in, kids, and just unwind for a little bit. What a great, safe place to do that. But then, after about 50 minutes or so, we gather them all up into a huddle, and we open up the Word of God, and we share Jesus with them. And a lot of these kids are not kids that are showing up here on Sunday or any other church on Sunday, but they're getting fed every single day. It's amazing. And then after we do that, we usually eat a little supper. We go out. We want the kids to get used to eating around a supper table and having conversation. And so we'll actually give them questions. And they have to sit around that table, and while they're eating, they have to have table conversation. How about that? Yeah, we grew up on that, didn't we? We take that for granted. A lot of these kids don't experience that. We want them to experience a family, a community, and get to know each other. And the kind of friendships that develop between kids of different grades and different, we have homeschool kids that show up. It's just a beautiful thing, kids coming together. So we enjoy stuffing our faces with each other for a little while. And then after that, we usually top off the day with a nasty game of dodgeball out in the gym. All right, so how can you top that? That's like the cherry on top. And while all that sounds like a lot of fun, and it is, you guys, can I just say this? In fact, I'm going to step it up a notch here because this guy in front of you is on a high from this past Friday because there were two middle school youngsters, one girl and one boy, who gave their life to Jesus at the Ladder Community Center. And it's like, thank you, Jesus, you are working in this community and in these kids. And now you know what the challenge is for us? We need to find adults that are willing to come alongside these baby believers, these new believers, and disciple them. So is that something that maybe interests you? So kids, if I'm a young person, I'm at the ladder, I'm just saying. We also have this thing called Kids Hope. And Kids Hope is pretty neat because we actually have volunteers that go into the elementary schools once a week for an hour and bless these kids like crazy. The stories that are coming out of the testimonies are phenomenal. And so that's another area that certainly you could be involved with. We have the Men and Ladies of Honor. See, we actually go into Shelby Middle School after school one day a week. It's a voluntary thing, but we present biblical manhood and biblical womanhood right out of the Bible in Shelby Middle School Library. What a privilege. And so we're able to get into the schools, and we have a great relationship with the schools and with young people. So that's just kind of the beginning with the youth, but it is powerful, okay? So I'm glad that you're excited about kids' lives being changed at the Ladder Community Center. How about if you're an old codger, though? What if you're an old person like you and me, right? 18 years and older. So if you're 18 plus, I'm calling you a codger. I just did that, all right? So here we go. If you're 18 years or older, there are all kinds of things that you can get involved with at the Ladder. There's food every single day. Lunch is served, and we also deliver lunches to shut-ins and so forth. And that's a great opportunity to have conversation with hurting people in our community, people that need a conversation, that need prayer. And we get to do that every day by delivering meals to them. It's pretty neat. So you can eat every single day. There's a walking class. There's a group that prays for cancer. There's or against cancer. How about that? Yeah, let's get rid of that. There's a women's Bible study. There's a men's prayer group. There's a men's Bible study. There's line dancing. How about that? There's a group that gets together to pray for our nation. There's a group called Celebrate Recovery that meets at the Ladder. We have pickleball, there's a treadmill, exercise bikes, there's weight machines in there. I mentioned that we deliver lunches every day, and then every Saturday evening, this is awesome on a Sunday, but last night, every Saturday night we have a worship service. Probably sing about a dozen songs about Jesus, prayer, Bible reading. It's amazing, you guys. We call it Celebrate, and that's what we do every Saturday night at the Ladder. Please come and join us someday. You might be so surprised, and you might want to bring an extra pair of socks because your socks might get blessed right off you. All right? So just want to encourage. And then there's always a puzzle going on there. There's Mexican train, pinochle, cribbage, bingo, euchre. I mean, the Ladder is a happening place, you guys. There is something for everybody at the Ladder. And that's one of the reasons why I'm so thankful to have a chance to share that with you, because as you're listening and you go, how could I get involved in that? How could I volunteer? How could I help? Oh, and there's so, so many ways to help and volunteer and to serve our great community, because we want the whole town to come to know the Lord Jesus. I wanted to say one other thing, and shame on me for forgetting this, because I'm the youth and men's coach. And there's a program, don't like that word. There's something going on right now at the Ladder. It's a little over a year old, and it's called Hero. Men, listen to this, Hero. A hero is a man who does manhood God's way. Not the world's way, God's way. And every Tuesday night at the Ladder, Hero meets. And it's just a bunch of men that get together. And there's usually teaching, so we get in the Bible a little bit, but mainly it's just men connecting with each other and encouraging each other in manhood God's way. Do you want to be a hero, men? I think there's a hero inside every single one of us. And there's definitely a need for everybody to have a hero, we need a hero. And so one of our dreams at the Ladder is that there will be a hero culture in Shelby, where when 40 years down the road, somebody comes up and says, Grandpa, tell me about the town. Do you have any heroes? Oh, yeah. My town was full of heroes. And they interacted with me. They took me under their wing. These were men who did things God's way. That's why our family's different, grandson. That's a dream. But I believe Jesus can do that. Do you? I just wanted to share some things about the Ladder with you today. And, you know, truth be told, while the Ladder exists in our community to help this community raise to new levels, when it comes to connecting with God, truth be told, We can't do it, can we? We can't climb, we cannot climb this ladder to get to God because we are so pitiful in our sin. We're crippled by our sin. We cannot help ourselves. If we could, we wouldn't need a God. But I'm so thankful that God loved us so much that he came from here and he stepped down that ladder and met us in Jesus. And he dwelt among us. Isn't that amazing? He loved us that much. He came down to us. And as a result of following Jesus, we can then have a relationship with God the Father. I believe that God the Father comes down this ladder and he meets people at New Era Reformed Church. He meets people here. And I believe that God comes down this ladder and he meets people at the Ladder Community Center every single day over there. Isn't that what we want? Him to be magnified, this whole community to come to know Christ Jesus, to have a relationship with God. Well, we have a dream that every single person in our community will meet again. Okay, in heaven, we will meet again, all because of Jesus. So if I've said Jesus about 13 or 15 times, just know that that's what we are about at the Ladder Community Center. And so your support is greatly appreciated, and I'm going to pray right now. Father God, thank you. Thank you, thank you so much for loving us so much. You decided to meet us. In fact, you're meeting us here this morning. Thank you, Father, for meeting us here this morning. And Lord, it's my prayer that over the course of these last couple minutes, if you have spoken to a heart that says, hey, that's how I can plug in at the ladder. I need that, or I'd like to support that. Lord, I'm praying that that every single person here would respond to that calling right now. And I am so looking forward to talking with people after the service about what you're doing in their lives and how you spoke to them through this goofy ladder announcement. Thank you, Lord, so much for your love. We worship you today in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, thank you. It's kind of a hard act to follow. So I just have a couple announcements that I wanted to highlight. In your bulletin is an insert about the Cookie Dough Frolic sign-up. There are actually two different dates that's going to be going on, but it was supposed to be printed back-to-back, so you would see both of them. But some of you got one that says December 16, and some of them say Friday, November 17. So it will probably be in the bulletin again next week, but I just want you to be aware of that. If you're looking at that, they're looking for some help. They're looking for stuff to do that. If you have questions, talk to Norma or Carolyn, but be looking for some more information about that. The cookie dough thing will be coming up in November and December. Then I also just wanted to highlight for those of you who were not able to be here last night for New Era's trick-or-treating. We hosted Trunk or Treat here again at church, and I don't really know who all was involved. I know Cece was kind of the coordinator of it, but it was amazing. They just went above and beyond and pulled out so much of the decorations from VBS and just had it decorated cool and had it over by the gym, and they had flyers that they handed out to families about the programs that we have at church, and Rianne would say we handed out probably over 250 flyers. We had so much candy. We ran out before 7 o'clock. And so Dave went and got more, and then we ran out of that. So I think there just were community people just know this is a place to come. And just were greeted with smiles and candy and welcoming. And so I just want to thank everybody who was a part of that and just recognize that we had an influence in our community last night. And I think that is something to really celebrate. So I'm thankful for that opportunity. And I'm going to call up Jim to lead us in prayer.
Let us pray. Our Father, as we approach you this morning, we stand in awe of your glory and majesty. We stand in awe of the beauty and the perfectibility of your creation. We confess that we have fallen short of your expectations for us. We confess that we often have done the things that we should not have done and have failed to do the things that we should have done. We confess that we often follow our will instead of your will. And we pray that you will forgive our sins. We thank you for the love and grace that you shower upon us. We thank you for Jesus Christ, who came to earth to teach us and show us how to live, who died on the cross for our sins, and who rose from the dead to show us that Christians can look forward to eternal life. We thank you for the Holy Spirit, who counsels, guides, helps, and leads us in our daily walk. And on this Reformation Sunday, we thank you for Martin Luther and John Calvin and the many other people who recognized that the church had lost its way and needed to be reformed and headed in a new direction. We pray for those in our congregation who are dealing with physical or mental challenges. Minister to them, comfort them, heal them. We pray for those who are facing difficulties in family, in their finances, in their job situations, in relationships. Help them to resolve those difficulties and to smooth out the rough places in their lives. We pray for our national, state, and local leaders that they will make wise decisions in a world that often seems full of violence and hatred. We pray for New Era Reformed Church, that we will be more than a group of people who meet for an hour or so on Sunday morning, that you will help us to continue to build a body of believers that share our gifts and talents and resources to build a Christian community that changes lives and that is a magnet for those outside of our walls who are looking for purpose and meaning in their lives. Finally, we pray for the sermon this morning. May you open our ears and our minds and our hearts so that we will not only hear the words, but absorb the message that Pastor Tully is bringing to us this morning. All these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
want to invite you to sing What a Friend We Have in Jesus. It's in your hymnals on page 435. And I just wanted to share a little personal story about this song. My dad has been gone for over 30 years, but I can remember going down to Florida to see him in his last couple days and singing this song to him on his deathbed. And it just has always been such a comforting song to me. And I have always been able to look at Jesus as my friend, not that it lowers his whatever to me, but it's also more comforting because I know he's easier to approach. So I just wanted to share that with you. Why don't you stand and join us?
To be with you folks, my wife Karen and I have worshiped with you a number of times, met some of you, talked with some of you, and wondering how this all came about. Well, Ben and I have been friends for a few years before you made the mistake of calling him as pastor. He and his family were worshiping at Fremont Orthodox Presbyterian Church, where my wife Karen and I attended. I am a retired minister in the Orthodox Presbyterian Church. I've served in some established pastorates, but I've also been a home missionary in the OPC, first in Ionia, Michigan, 25 or so years ago. We thought that there couldn't be any worse weather anywhere in the lower states. Worse weather than in Michigan until we moved to North Dakota. Fargo, North Dakota. I was a home missionary there in the Orthodox Presbyterian Church. There's nothing like it. I mean,
for 5 months of snow. That's all you see. People aren't out. Kids aren't out building snowmen, playing outside. Blizzard, snow blizzard with lightning. Have you ever had that? Our last winter there, they did a, I don't know if you'd call it a playoff, for the most treacherous weather in the United States. It came down to a little town in Pennsylvania and Fargo, and Fargo won. And we all got new down coats for that. It's unbelievable. Also, that last spring we were there, they recorded the largest, biggest tornadic storm in history anywhere in the world. Full 70-some tornadoes in one storm. Barely missed Fargo. They spend $5 million a year sandbagging around Fargo to protect it from flooding the Red River in the spring. Great people. Norwegians, that's how they can take it. So, yeah, my name. You know, Ben and I have a lot of things in common. Obviously, he's out hunting today. Yeah, we have to get him for that. Why didn't he take me with him? We fished together. We haven't hunted together yet. I'm an avid traditional bow hunter. So we have a lot of things in common. Another thing, though, we have in common is it's very difficult to pronounce our last names. My last name is pronounced Thole, T-H-O-L-E. Does it sound like that? So I still can't pronounce Ben's last name, Pastor Ben's last name. Is he related to Laurence Olivier, the great British actor? We want to thank you for your prayers on behalf of my wife, Karen, seated over there. She will be having a surgery November the 8th. For her heart, a valve, heart valve replacement, as you continue to pray for her in regard to that. I ask you to turn with me to Psalm 51. The reason I have chosen this is because I was thinking continuing Pastor Ben's series on prayer. So we have this penitential prayer of David. I'm going to copy Ben here. Notice that he uses this as a second book stand. So I ask you to turn with me to Psalm 51. So let's hear God's word to us. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you are right in your verdict, and justified when you judge. Surely I was sinful in birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Yet you desired faithfulness even in the womb. You taught me wisdom in that secret place. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquity. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Then I will teach transgressors your ways so that sinners will turn back to you. Deliver me from the guilt of bloodshed, O God, you who are God my Savior, and my tongue will sing of your righteousness. Open my lips, Lord, and my mouth will declare your praise. You do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. My sacrifice, O God, is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. You, God, will not despise. May it please you to prosper Zion, to build up the walls of Jerusalem. Then you will delight in the sacrifices of the righteous and burnt offerings offered whole. Then bulls will be offered on your altar. Let us pray. Well, Lord our God, Heavenly Father, we do thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, that in your word you have revealed yourself to us, your attributes. Lord, and we praise you for all of those great attributes. We glorify your name. We thank you, Lord, that in your word you have revealed to us, the Lord Jesus Christ, the way of redemption, the way of eternal life. Now, as we hear your word, consider your word, Lord, we pray for a gracious work of the Holy Spirit in our hearts, our minds. Write your word, we pray, upon our hearts. And we do pray in Christ's name. Amen. I wasn't always reformed in theology. My wife and I grew up in the Church of God out of Anderson, headquarters in Anderson, Indiana. Wesleyan holiness in theology, very anti-reformed, anti-Calvinism. And they believe, I don't know what they believe now, I've been around them very much, but they have held to the idea that the saints of the Old Testament were saved by works of the law. They misinterpret, of course, Paul's teaching about we are no longer under the law but under grace. What Paul's really saying there, telling us, is the law, when we come to Christ, the law has done its work. Paul says through the law we come to the knowledge of sin. He says over in Galatians that the law is our childbearer. The King James says schoolmaster. That's not quite what the Greek means. The childbearer was this tough guy, kind of a really rough guy that would go around and pick up kids at these different families, homes, and lead them to school. And he was rough, tough. And the law is our schoolmaster, our child bearer, paedagogos, to lead us to Christ. So through the law comes the knowledge of sin. We are, there's no life in the law, there's condemnation. So we stand before the Lord condemned in our sins, and our only hope is the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the first purpose of the law, to lead us to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. I cut my teeth on D. Martin Lloyd-Jones to become Reformed. He pastored a large church in London. He spent 12 years preaching through the book of Romans. 12 years, verse by verse by verse. Here's what he says. Listen to the words. The Apostle Paul delights in repeating the things of the gospel. And our delight in repeating them also is the measure of our understanding of the faith. One of the signs of the true Christian is that he never tires of the gospel. He longs to hear it, even in its simplest form. Is that true of you? Is that true of us? Can we ever tire of hearing the gospel? I was reading some book the other day, it just came to my mind. I can't remember who the author was. I can't even remember the name of the book, but he was talking about how so many people today and so many churches where there's the absence of the gospel, it's like once you become a believer, so many believers think, well, I'm a believer now. I believe in Christ. I believe the Bible and so on. So I don't need the gospel. The gospel is for unbelievers. Is that true? Can we ever have too much of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ? Yet there are many professing Christians that think that way. I've heard it. I once went to church several years ago with relatives, came home, and it was a good sermon. He went to his church, and he said it was boring. I've heard it all. Heard it all? Heard it all? How can we ever plumb the depths of the gospel? They are still writing books about justification by faith in Christ. How can we, what? Plumb the depths? Never. So here we come to Psalm 51, which is full of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen to the words of Calvin. It says, we ought to read scriptures with the express design of finding Christ in them. Do you do that? Do we do that? The express purpose of finding Christ in the scriptures. I didn't finish the one idea that I got into earlier. This came to me. My wife, I was saying how we grew up in this church that pretty much just the Old Testament was moralism. There wasn't the gospel there. I didn't finish that. So all the sermons were from the Old Testament were all about just moralism. Doing this and don't do that. There's no Christ. There's no Christ in it. Well, this is why Luther says Christ is on every page. Every page of Scripture, Christ is on every page in one way or another. So we find in Psalm 51, the gospel. We need to hear it. We need to hear the gospel again and again and again, reminded of the gospel, reminded of the grace of God, reminded that our sufficiency is in the Lord Jesus Christ. I think probably everybody here has heard of Joyce Meyer. Highly celebrated, popular author of so many books. She says, we don't need to hear this gospel. We don't sin anymore. We don't. If we sin, then Christ died in vain if we continue to sin. What? A false gospel. Yet Paul says in Romans 7 that I do the very thing I hate. There's battle going on between the old man, remains of the flesh, and his love for the Lord, his love for the law of God. And 1 John says, anyone who says he is without sin is a liar. A liar. So we come to Psalm 51. And note the heading there. Talks about Nathan. 4 years has passed since the sin of David, of murder and of adultery. Listen to the words of Matthew Henry, the Puritan. He says, the title has reference to a very sad story, that of David's fall. But though he fell, he was not utterly cast down, for God graciously upheld him and raised him up, bringing him to repentance, bringing him to renewal, bringing him to renewed fellowship with the Lord, renewing to him the joy of his salvation. So we have here a model for us. Repentance, the need to repent. Luther said one time, Luther wrote that the Christian life is a life of constant repentance. Constant repentance. Several years ago, I was traveling with my mother, and I said something about sin, and she said, you sin? She said, do you think I sin? She said, I don't smoke, and I don't drink, and I don't do immoral things. And I said, well, yeah, sure. Right here, sitting right here, right now, I'm sinning. I don't love the Lord God with all my heart, mind, soul, and strength. I don't do all to the glory of God. This is why we need Christ. Our sufficiency is in Him and in Him alone. And here we have a great model for us in David's repentance and then in his restoration. And in this process, there are many lessons for us. And this is often called the sinner's guide. Every one of us, everyone has these needs: reconciliation and transformation. Psalm 51 is one of what we call the penitential psalms. So here we have the tragic story of David. Nathan comes to him, gives him this story about how there's this guy, this rich guy, king. He has all these sheep and everything, and he looks over here at this poor man, and that guy has the sheep, and he takes his sheep, and David gets all, you know the story, gets all upset, said, that guy, he's a bad guy, evil guy. And Nathan says, that's you. He'd gone on 4 years without a confession of his sins of murder and adultery. But God in his grace sent the prophet Nathan to him. And so we have here in Psalm 51, verses 1 through 12, David's prayer of repentance and restoration to God after God had broken David's heart. Before we consider verse 10, which really is the focus of the message today, I'd like to get for us to understand the context here. Notice, first of all, in verse 1, he pleads the mercy of God. Let's turn to that again. I'd like to remind you of that. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion. Blot out my transgressions. So he doesn't plead anything but the mercy of God. He doesn't plead his merit, anything like that, what he's done, what he might do to make somehow please God. He pleads only the mercy of Almighty God. Second thing that he does is he recognizes that his very soul is stained. He says, wash me, cleanse me. What is he saying there? What is he praying? He's praying that God would do something with his heart. Then what does he do? He owns sin as his own sin. He confesses it as transgressions, iniquity, evil. It is sin, iniquity. That's the nature of sin. It is evil. It is iniquity. It's as if he can't say enough about all of this. And here's where we all must begin, always begin, for restoration, confessing that very same thing. You and I must call it what God calls it, sin. It's not a mistake. It's not a failure. It's not a personality problem. That's what I heard again and again in the church, that church of God, that taught that you could reach a point where you no longer sin. Oh, that person just has a personality problem. No. No. Not a mistake. David calls it sin. And you and I need to learn this. It's a part of true confession that leads to restoration. Then notice in verses 3 and 4, he owns it as his own sin. 6 times he says, I, me, my. He says that whole thing, adultery, murder, all these things were a product of my own wicked heart. And isn't that what James tells us? James chapter 1. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. David was drawn away by his own lusts. By his own lusts. And so the principle of this is this: true forgiveness, true repentance before God that leads to restoration is owning up to our own sin, not blaming anybody else, not blaming the circumstances. I tell you, you've heard it again and again. You've read it in the news and so on. I've counseled people that years, they, for years, they blame their parents for where they are, the problems that they're having, or blame this person for it, or blames that person for the problems they have. Okay, people affect us. That's true. But we're not slaves in this. We have the Lord Jesus Christ. We have the work of the Holy Spirit to help us in these things, deliver us from these things. Then in verse 5, David confesses the nature of sin. The root source is sinful nature, which we all have to deal with as a result of this sin of Adam. As Paul tells us, sin entered the world through that one transgression by Adam. And death entered, but life and righteousness through that one man, Lord Jesus Christ, through the one man. Come to verse 6, I would say is sort of what we call a transitional verse between verses 1 and 5 and 7 through 12. Notice what he says again in verse 6, what he tells us. Yet you desired faithfulness, even in the womb. You taught me wisdom in that secret place. So then he goes, verse 7, cleanse me with hyssop and I will be clean. Wash me and I will be whiter than snow. So what's he saying? It's not enough that our lives be conformed to the letter of the law. It's not enough. The heart must be purified. God desires that his truth reach deep into the recesses of our minds and our hearts, because whatever rules your heart rules your life. Whatever rules your heart, your affections, your desires, rules your life. Then in verse 7, he says, talks about cleansing by God's appointed means. Purge me, cleanse me in a specific way, wash me. But why hyssop? What was hyssop? Well, it's a plant, it's sponge-like. It was used as an instrument in purifying or cleansing, ceremonially cleansing the instruments of temple worship, symbolized cleansing, a sprinkle. Remember, the hyssop was used to sprinkle blood on the mercy seat. Moses sprinkled the people with hyssop, blood, drenched in blood. So what is the essence here of David's prayer? What is he getting at? He's getting at this. Oh Lord, cleanse me by your mercy. Cleanse me by your grace. It's not external ceremony I know that you want of me. What does he see? He sees that by faith, that blood of the coming Messiah was to be shed for him. We know that. Look at the list of the heroes of faith in Hebrews chapter 11. Look how many times. This is so difficult to understand, but these patriarchs, Abraham, all these men, Moses and so on, they didn't have the understanding that we have of Christ, of course. But it says that Moses gave up all the riches for the sake of Christ. Isn't that an amazing thing? For Christ's sake. We're told, Paul says that Abraham believed the gospel that was proclaimed beforehand to him. And that promise given to him that through him the nations would be blessed, Paul says that was the gospel. And he says, Abraham believed God and it was accounted to him as righteousness. Oh, Lord, cleanse me. Verse 8, praise to God for mercy and grace, forgiveness, cleansing. Restore to me, he says, the joy of my salvation. Do you realize that? That our sin can rob us, can rob you of the joy of your salvation. Have you learned that? Perhaps you're experiencing it right now. Then he prays again for mercy, that God by his grace would remove his guilt. Hide your face from my sins. Lord, do not look upon my sin. Of course, it's poetic language. God doesn't have a face. Blot out my transgression. He's saying, by your grace, remove my sin from your record book. Blot out that indictment against me. Isn't that an amazing thing? Then we have verse 10, which really is our focus, but then let's move on and come back to that. Verse 11, notice what he says here in verse 11. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Of course, he's not saying that God is not omnipresent. He's just talking about the loss of fellowship, have a sense of the presence of God. You know that that's one of the most important things you can have in your life, is a sense of you live in the presence of Almighty God. What a help that is to you in your dealing with temptation, with sin, in your dealing with discouragements and so on, that you're never out. It can be a scary thing sometimes. It can be. But to know, believe that God, you're constantly in God's presence. What an amazing thing that is. How that will temper all, affect all that you do. And it's amazing how it works in the life of a Christian. Paul had that. Paul had this sense of the presence of God, Almighty God, in his life. Constant presence. So he's not here denying the omnipresence of the Lord. But David is saying, don't take away from me the experience of your presence in my life. Then we have in verse 12 the same idea that we have in verse 8. David pleads, work in my heart. Work in my heart. I ask not only for restoration and joy, but for the preservation of that joy. And unless you uphold me, I will go right back and do the same thing tomorrow. Tomorrow. And then verse 13, notice again what he says here, what he writes. And I will teach transgressors your way so that sinners will turn back to you. So the fruit, one of the fruits of this restoration is getting his joy back and declaring the goodness, the mercy, the grace of Almighty God to others. You know, I've taught a lot about witnessing and evangelism. I talk to people about it. It's one of the things that I've really stressed in my pastorate. This is one of the things that will empower you to be a witness for Christ, making certain that your conscience is right with the Lord. It will empower you to be a strong witness for the Lord Jesus Christ, to declare God's mercy, to be able to share with others what you've gone through, how you have found grace, mercy in the Lord Jesus Christ. Then verses 16 and 17, we have these verses, they go together, I would say. So what is he saying here? Is he saying that God never has commanded these things? No, clearly it's not true. Those sacrifices had some value. They would test the people's obedience to him. It was pleasing to God to, through these sacrifices, to turn away his wrath against them. And above all, as Hebrews stresses so many places, the Epistle of Hebrews, the sacrificial system, the priesthood and all of that was a type of the Lord Jesus Christ. They were all shadows of the real thing. David says, I know, O Lord, that you require more than the spilling of the blood of animals. And then he says, verse 17, my Sacrifice, O God, is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. You, God, will not despise. It is, as one person put it, a broken and contrite heart is a heart deeply afflicted for sin, humbled on the sense of God's displeasure, and earnestly seeking and willing to accept reconciliation with God on His terms. On His terms. Then closes with this: may it please you to prosper Zion, to build up the walls of Jerusalem. Then you will delight in the sacrifices of the righteous, and burnt offerings offered whole, and bulls will be offered on your altar. Then that brings us to verse 10, which James Boyce, I don't know if you've ever heard of him, great Reformed pastor, passed away several years ago, pastored 10th Presbyterian Church in Pennsylvania for many, many years. He and Calvin call this the climax of this psalm, verse 10. So what is he doing here? He's been praying for pardon, that God would pardon his sins. But now he prays for his sanctification. When David prays this, what is he doing? What is he praying? He's saying, oh God, as in the beginning, when you brought the world and heaven out of nothing by your sovereign creative power, so create something in me. You see, the world, the word create shuts us up to this sovereign, absolute sovereign, almighty work of God. It's the same word that we read three times in Genesis, in the creation narrative. So David is asking for nothing less than a miracle. It must be a creation out of nothing. Why? Out of nothing. Why? Because if any of it came from David himself, that little bit would poison everything. And so David prays to God that God would create in him a clean heart. So David's concern is not physical organ, of course, but the seat of his affections, his will, his desires. Listen to these words of Thomas Reed, a theologian. Says, when we are spiritually taught of God to know something of the desperate wickedness and deceitfulness of our hearts, then we are prepared to feel the force of this exhortation. Feel the force of this exhortation. We find this again, the same concern in verse 6 there. When we dig down deep in our lives, when we get beneath all of our actions, all of our words, we finally get to the seat, the root of the problem, where all of it flows out of our affections, our hearts. And that is what David means, create in me a clean heart, a pure heart. Oh God, do something in me. Get at the bedrock of my life. Get to that place where I can't get to, that thing that I can't get to. Create in me a clean heart. And then David parallels that with, and renew a right spirit or steadfast spirit within me. The idea is to renew. The idea is bringing something back to its original state. And so David is praying, oh God, renew within me a right, a steadfast spirit. Establish me, fix it, render it sure. Lord, I sin because my spirit was fickle. I sin because I was not fixed upon holiness and upon purity. Oh, Lord, help me. Create in me a clean heart. When temptation came to me, I was not as Joseph. Remember Joseph? When he was tempted by Potiphar's wife? How can I do this? How can I do this and sin against God? The same accusation is brought in Psalm 78:37 against the children of Israel. Their heart was not steadfast toward God. What happened? When they faced difficulty after leaving Egypt, they said, oh, if only we had died in Egypt. Why did we leave Egypt? Look what God has brought us to. He's brought us to this. What was the problem? Their spirit was not steadfast toward God. They did not believe his promise to give them that land. And that's what David says about himself. I'll never forget a really, really good friend of mine. Many, many years ago, he's not with us anymore. He's with the Lord. He says, the heart of the problem is the problem of the heart. It is. The heart of the problem is the problem of the heart. So it was with David, so it is with us. Isn't it the words of Charles Spurgeon? None but God can create either a new heart or a new earth. The heart is the rudder of the soul until the Lord take it. In hand, we steer in a false and foul way. And so David prays, and may we pray, O Lord, put steel in my spirit. Make it steadfast. Create, O God, what is not there. Renew what is not there. Then specifically, what lessons are there here for us? First of all, there's a lesson here for us on the biblical balance of David's prayer. We learn how thoroughly biblical David's prayer is. Listen to the words of Matthew Henry, the great Puritan. He says, David prays for a complete and effectual pardon. Hide your face. By your grace, cast them behind your back. By your mercy, forget them. Blot them out. He prays in verse 9, Lord, hide your face from my sin. What's the point? David recognized that all sin, not blotted out by God's grace through the Lord Jesus Christ, is like a loud voice crying out for God's judgment. And David is thinking of his sin. Sin is in the record book of God bringing indictment against David. Not the loss of his salvation, but he feels this indictment against him, this heaviness of his sin. He knows he's sinned against the holy God. He's not in full fellowship with God, an open fellowship with his God. His conscience is not clear before God, Almighty God, and he wants that. So he cries out, O Lord, blot out my transgressions. What this really is speaking of is the idea that justification is really a legal term, which is being denied by so many today. That we stand condemned by the law of God, condemned by him, but through faith in Christ, we are justified, declared righteous in his sight, having met all the law of God. Let me ask you a question. Are we still bound to obey the law of God? Are we? Absolutely. Can we obey the law of God? Absolutely not. Not completely, not perfectly. So how do we do that? Through Christ. Christ perfect, obeyed the law in all things. And it's passive obedience and laying down his life, is active obedience and is perfect obedience. Sinless life as the Son of God, the eternal God-man. And you fulfill the law of God through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul talks about how Christ's sin is righteousness is laid upon us, upon you, by faith in him. So we have these two great blessings of the new covenant. God says, I'll do something in their hearts. I will write my law upon their hearts, and I will do something in the record book of their sin. I'll remember their sin no more. So when the Lord Jesus Christ shed his blood, he did so for those two things, those two blessings. But this is not only true of the beginning of the Christian life, and this is something that we need to learn. It's so difficult for us to get straight. Our sins constantly are before us. And we need them to be blotted out. We need to plead constantly the shed blood the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. 1 John 1, 9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to do what? To do two things, to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. What a blessing. What a blessing that is. Second lesson on this is the nature, the essence of the Christian life. What is it? What is the nature? What do we learn here about the nature or the essence of the Christian life? That it is internal, that it is inward. So we read this in verse 6, written in verse 10, of course, where he talks about the heart. He talks again and again about the inward parts, the hidden parts, a contrite heart, a broken spirit. 6 times we have these words in David's prayer. So what is he telling us? What does he mean by all this? They tell us that there is this essential inwardness of the Christian life. Emphasis upon the heart, upon the affections. Do you realize that? This is why we're told in Proverbs 4:23, and keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. See, here's the problem. Here's what we face. Satan, one of his devices, I don't know if you've ever read Richard Sibbes, great book on, I think it's Sibbes, Puritan, Satan's devices. One of his devices is get you as a believer to focus upon the external. And if you've done that, you're right with God. That's one of the things he wants you to do. Focus upon the externals. Doing this, not doing that, and not upon the heart, not upon your affections, not upon your love for the Lord Jesus Christ. It's in the heart where all these things are rooted. And so David is careful here to trace his confession back to his heart condition. He says, elsewhere, I will walk in my house in the integrity of my heart. With my whole heart have I sought you. This is so important. David has come to realize that he had failed to guard his heart. He had come to realize by God's grace that all that lust, adultery, and murder would not have been had he steadfastly guarded his heart. The Puritan John Flavel says the greatest difficulty is to win the heart. He's talking about conversion. To win the heart to God. He means it takes a miracle of God. And the greatest difficulty after conversion is to keep the heart with God. Do you realize that? That's where our real battle is. And Satan doesn't want us there. Satan doesn't want you there. Jesus says in Matthew 12, the mouth speaks out of what fills the heart. Matthew 15, Jesus corrects the Pharisees' preoccupation with outward defilement. Hear and understand. Listen carefully. Pay close attention. Pay close attention. There's only one person that can be ever smitten with his sins. That's one who sees that he has sinned against Almighty God, who, as the Westminster Confession says, grieves over his sin, hates his sin, and then turns to Christ. Do you hate your sin? The only one who hates his sin is the one who sees that he stands before a holy, holy God. So David prays, created me a clean heart. Not half a clean heart, because the purer the heart, the purer the life, the purer the life. Listen to, in conclusion, Thomas Reed's little poem, a Puritan from the 1800s. May this be our prayer. Fill me, O Lord, with holy joy, with humble filial fear. Filial, what does it mean by like love, out of love? Love for God, not a that kind of fear, fear of the awesomeness of God. My undivided heart employ in praise to thee in prayer. Protect me from the power of ill. Defend my soul from sin. Subdue my proud, rebellious will and make me pure within. Create an ardent, active love, thy goodness to proclaim. O may I sweetly feel and prove the power of Jesus' name. May Jesus my beloved be, my shepherd and my friend. Unite my soul, O Lord, to thee, in bonds that ne'er shall end. Then shall my raptured soul repeat the wonders of thy grace, until prostrate at thy mercy seat, I view thee face to face. Let us pray. Lord our God, Heavenly Father, we do thank you for your word. What words these are to us, words of life, life-giving, life-changing. How we pray, O Lord, that by your grace, by a powerful work of the Holy Spirit, a gracious work of the Holy Spirit, your word to us through David, by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, Lord, you be used to sanctify us, Lord, to face up to our sins against you, that we would have a greater and greater love for Christ, knowing that we do have a Savior who will never leave us nor forsake us, a Savior who is ready to receive us no matter what, that it is a throne of grace that he sits upon, not a throne of condemnation, throne of grace. Help us, O Lord, to remember that. O Lord, we do pray these things in the name of Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Would you please stand with us? We're going to sing hymnal number 436, Whiter Than Snow.
Thank you.
Congregation of our Lord Jesus Christ, receive God's benediction. Now may grace, peace, and mercy be upon all who love our Lord Jesus Christ with a love undying. Amen.